A warm good afternoon to all the participants present here. So on behalf of SBC Department of Civil Engineering, I'm very much happy to welcome you all for this last session of today's program. So in this occasion, I'm very happy to welcome Dr. PC Ashwin Kumar, who's presently Assistant Professor in the Department of Earthquake Engineering, IIT Roorkee. So I'm very much happy to introduce Dr. PC Ashwin Kumar to all the participants present here. So Dr. P.C. Ashwin Kumar is serving as Assistant Professor in the Department of Earthquake Engineering, IIT Roorkee, since 2018. So before that, he has industrial experience also. So he served in various companies like EDR Private Limited, WSP Global Limited. While working in the WSP company, he received the Star Performer Award for the year 2012. So coming to his educational background, he did his B.Tech Civil Engineering from Government Engineering College, Thrissur, Kerala, year 2006. Then he has completed his M.Tech Structural Engineering from IIT Madras in the year 2010. He completed his Ph.D. Structural Engineering from IIT Delhi in the year 2017. And he is supervising many project works for the students. Also, he has published many papers in various international journals to his credit. He has also published a book chapter titled Effect of Brace Configurations on Seismic Behavior of SCBFs in Advances in Structural Engineering Dynamics. He has also published about 11 conference papers in his credit. So with this brief introduction, I would like to invite Dr. P.C. Ashwin Kumar to take over the session.
Thank you very much, ma'am, for the warm introduction. Good afternoon, participants. So we have joined here to learn about steel passive devices for seismic resilience. And since we are in the afternoon session, so I have we have to travel along, but I have put in few questions in between where I would want your participation, so that this is a lively participation as well as you learn a lot during the presentation. So let's get on with it. What happened in 2011? Now, this is a real fact with which I'm starting this presentation, is that in 2011, you must have heard about the Christchurch earthquake and all, which actually caused a devastation where only lives which were lost, which was only 185, but the cost of that particular devastation was too resounding that till now, till date, the construction activity in that area is still going on. So what you see in this pic right here on the left side is the central business district that resided many commercial establishments and all, which saw a large amount of damage to the structures.
Now, sorry to disturb Dr. Ashwin Kumar. Is it possible to switch on your video? I suppose if it is not a problem for you.
There was some plugin being installed. So I don't know why. Okay. There was some issue. I had kept it on only.
Okay. No issues.
Yeah. So pre-Canterbury, that Christchurch earthquake in 2011, the type of structures that were built in the central business district, I mean, we are looking at only one particular area where the maximum amount of damage was concentrated. So in that area, only RC structures, reinforced concrete structures, were being built. Now, post 2011, post that earthquake, the construction practice which was followed earlier with RCC, a total shift in construction activity was seen, where the structural steel started making its impact. Now in India also, we are using RCC mainly for our construction due to cost issues, mainly that steel is much more costlier in India. Same was the case in Christchurch, but the reasons that I'm shown here, that two reasons that I've shown here, one is that there was a decrease in the rates of steel, structural steel, which was being manufactured or being procured from outside, was reduced. And as well as the structures, which were steel structures, which are already there in that particular zone, actually behaved much better than RCC structures. So you can guess the people, where would they go? The other reason was that if you can see on the right side, like if you can see here, you can see, can anyone identify the type of steel structure this is? Can anyone identify the structural form which is given here in this photo? Okay, we'll come to this.
Is it a PEB structure?
Come again, sir, please.
Is it a PEB structure?
It's not a pre-engineered building structure. It is a structural frame, as you call a moment resisting frame. There are different types of structural frames which are there in passive devices. As a term, as I've said, passive devices. So it is one of them. I'll come to that. This is one of the devices that we'll discuss today. So if you can see clearly, what has happened is that you can see no damages in this area. This is a brace here. This is another diagonal brace here. But the damage you can see in this particular area, we'll come to after in a few slides, we'll come to know what we call this device as and why the damage is located in here. But if you look at the picture below, this is the same frame after, this is right after the 2011 earthquake, where this device has helped in dissipating the earthquake energy imparted to the structure. But after that, after the structure has got little bit damaged in this location, it has been replaced after this earthquake. So you can see a line here. This is like this particular structure has been cut from here and here, and then it has been replaced by a new structural steel. So the downtime in terms of replacing the damaged structure with respect to a kind of a new type of framework that has been brought in has taken very less amount of time. You can see that cut here in the brace. You can see the cut here in the brace. So basically the damage was concentrated here. So in order to make it renew that particular framework, they just cut few pieces here and there and installed a new one. So their earthquake resistance system, this is one of those passive earthquake resistance systems which we are going to talk about. They have very less time frame in terms of getting the structure back to its original seismic resistance level. So that was another advantage that saw. They saw that the steel prices are less. They again saw the performance of the existing steel structures which were there during the 2011 earthquake fared very well in comparison to concrete structures. And third thing was the time it took from the event happening till the time it could be occupied again and the commercial activity can be started again was very short in terms of steel structures in comparison to RCC structures. So you can see a picture here of that central business district before the earthquake, after the earthquake, and months after the earthquake in 2012, 14 months. Now the picture in 2012, it looks very much in a case of devastated, like everything and debris have been removed. All the existing structures that were there were brought down. You can see the numbers, thousands of buildings were demolished. But what this gives us as an opportunity is that in India, where we are more inclined upon using RCC structures based mainly because of the monetary benefit that it gives, that the material is less costly, the labor is cheap here. So in terms of that, we are inclined to using RCC structures. We have our design procedures for RCC structures well developed, but there are certain problems in terms of post-earthquake, the way in which we can come back to its original state, or you have heard about things like immediate occupancy, whether we can immediately occupy the structure after the earthquake or whether it can be made operational right after the earthquake or not. So the downtime is less in terms of steel structures, and what you can see here is post 2011 earthquake, those people have started construction into various types of devices that you can see. So you can see various structural, structural systems that they had adopted, in which the common steel moment resisting frames are there, steel concentrically braced frames are there, steel buckling restrained braced frames are there, BRBF that we know as, and steel eccentrically braced frame. The figure that you saw earlier was that of an eccentrically braced frame, where if you can see what is the difference between concentrically and eccentrically braced frame is that if you look at the center line of the brace, the beam and the column, they all coincide. Matlab, if you see draw a center line for this particular brace here, it coincides with the center line of the beam, but that is not the case. You have a gap in between. The center line of the brace does not coincide with the center line at the center position of this particular beam at this level. If it is a CBF, it will be directly connecting at this level. If it is a concentrically braced frame, it will be connecting here, but there is a small gap which is given. And this is where the damage is getting concentrated. I mean, I'll come to it why we are happy with having this particular damage in an eccentrically braced frame and why these people who have shifted to these new structural systems are opting for these systems. These are all passive devices. Steel concentrically braced frame, buckling restrained braced frame, eccentrically braced frames are all types of passive devices which are used in your main structure to actually concentrate the damage in such type of devices and kind of safeguard your main structural components like beams and columns, which are carrying the gravity loads. Clear? So we'll first look into our steel moment resisting frames. So steel moment resisting frames, you will understand this is a very simple kind of structural system. And the earliest one, I mean the most oldest kind of structural system that people have been using in steel structures are the moment resisting frames, which is still used in nowadays also. So the earliest building, the 1884 Chicago Home Insurance Building, was there built. You can see the type of connections that was used to build that particular structure. You can see various amount of built up sections that are coming in there. Very large depth gusset plates, or what you say stiffening plates, are used in terms of stiffening the beams and all. So this was a very rigid connection, extremely rigid connection that was used during the earlier times, as well as they were kind of giving very thick infill walls in between the columns and all. So the advantage of those infill wall being there, giving additional stiffness to the structure, was also aiding to its better performance during the earthquake. But later on, when the Empire State Building came in, they started going in for started to do efficiency in terms of their calculation as well as in their connections. Instead of giving a very rigid kind of connection, they started reducing the amount of material that is being utilized in a connection. And then when in the 1960s and 70s, they started testing their connections. All types of testing, like you see beam column joint testing, connection testing to check whether it is giving the ideal behavior under cyclic loads. I mean, cyclic loads, you mean during earthquake, there is deformation, positive and negative deformation in a structure. Similarly, your connection will be subjected to that cyclic movement of that particular thing, where you expect the connection or the members to fail under fatigue. Fatigue in the sense, not the high cycle fatigue nor the low cycle fatigue. We are talking about ultra low cycle fatigue failure of the connection. Ultra low cycle fatigue, why we say so, is that key during earthquake, we expect the connection to fail within 20 to 25 cycles of loading itself, it fails. So you're not talking about low cycle fatigue where you're talking about 10 raised to 5, some thousands or millions of cycles. We are talking about only 20 to 25 cycles during a 30 second duration earthquake, which can fail the connection. Now, all these developments from 1884, from the first moment resisting frame structures to come up till the time in 1994 Northridge earthquake, steel moment resisting frame has been considered as one of the best way to deal with earthquake forces. Now, after the Northridge earthquake, what has happened is that what they found out is that many connections were having certain failures, which you can see. You can see this is the beam, the bottom of the beam flange you can see here. And you can see the crack getting propagated from this particular connection location where complete joint penetration weld has been given here. And then the crack is propagating from the column flange to it is propagating back to the web of the column. Now, people didn't expect this at that time. They said, okay, moment resisting frame has been behaving better than RCC structures. They were all going into steel structures in terms of their construction practices. But Northridge opened everyone's eyes. 1994 Northridge earthquake, as well as 1995 Kobe earthquake, actually opened people's eyes in terms of, see, something is wrong there, something has not been. But the thing was, during 60s and 70s, the connections that we see here in this picture was actually tested. It was actually tested. You can see the kind of connections that currently we also practice here in terms of giving a shear tab and giving connection to the flanges of the beam using a complete joint penetration weld. This represents a rigid connection, and people have been doing this practice even before Northridge. They have tested. I mean, we don't have such test regime, but they were testing their connections. So what they found out is that they found out many problems with what they were actually doing. Large beam and column sections, material properties was bad, their welding practices were bad, and then the kind of welding material and the access hole, weld access hole that they were giving, those were providing certain stress concentration area in that particular connection, which had caused this particular earthquake to occur. So the practice again started. Okay, post Northridge earthquake, people started testing even more of these connections, and many new things have come about. And here I want to mention that currently, if you look at this particular code, ANSI AISC, American Institute of Steel Construction 35816, this is a code there. They have defined certain number of pre-qualified connections, some 9 to 12 pre-qualified connections have been made in such a way that if you say pre-qualified means, they have tested, they have made a design procedure, they have set the range in which it will work in such a way that if you use that design methodology and apply it in your structure, you are guaranteed a basic performance, an acceptable performance from the connection without any kind of unfavorable behavioral conditions developing in the connection. So this is the level. Current status of connection design in US and all is with pre-qualified connections being made. Now, we'll come to this particular connection that you see here. This you call the hysteresis diagram, which is telling you the load deformation curve in terms of when the cyclic load is being applied. And the area inside the hysteresis curve represents the energy that is dissipated by that particular member connection or any other component or sub-assemblies that you are testing. Now, the more the area inside the hysteresis curve, the better the energy that is getting dissipated inside. But we want to know, like, okay, if you have given a pre-qualified connection, whether it is the connection should dissipate the energy, or is it the beam that should dissipate the energy, or is it the column that should do the work, that is what we have to first decide. So in terms of any structural system from now on, from today, let us understand that if I'm looking at a structural system, whether it be RC moment resisting frame, whether it be steel moment resisting frame, whether it be buckling restraint brace frame, we have to first understand and make sure that what is it that we want from the structural performance? What will you call as the favorable performance of the structural system? So in terms of moment resisting frames, throughout the research that has been done for more than 100 years, rest of all of the systems are like 20, 25 years old, some are 10 years old. Moment resisting frame has been studied over 100 years. And even then, we still know a bit more is left in terms of understanding how that system works. But what we know is that if I say what should be the favorable phenomenon in terms of dissipating the energy and keeping my structure safe under a mild earthquake and collapse not occurring under a severe earthquake, I want the hinges or the plastic deformations to occur mainly in the beams. And then it is acceptable to have plastic hinges in the column at the bottom level and the bottom of the ground story. That is good enough for a favorable performance, which means I don't want any collapse in the structure, but what I am accepting is that there may be plastic, inelastic deformations in the beams as well as columns. I want mostly it in beams, but not majorly in the columns, because columns are the main structural member. If column fails, then everything else will come down. So this is how you're dissipating the energy in a moment resisting frame. But this particular instance, even though we have said, yes, I am liking the inelastic deformations to be concentrated in the beam, but I should not allow it to go beyond a certain level. Now, what should I avoid? I mean, if inelastic deformations are occurring, you are expecting such phenomena to happen, that local buckling of beams and column flanges can occur, and large deformations of web can also occur. If this can happen right now in the figure, you can see the actually web of the beam is having some kind of yielding that has occurred, and the flange also has some kind of local buckling that has occurred in it. So this will happen. See, I'm not saying that if you design it perfectly, you won't have such kind of behavior. No, it is not that key. It should not happen. It should happen after a certain stage. It should not happen at a very premature stage. If local buckling happens in a beam section or a column section or the panel zone, in terms of when the loads are being applied, it will negate the kind of energy dissipation that the structure should behave like, and it can cause even the collapse of the structure. So we understood, okay, this is the desirable performance that we want. So in terms of unfavorable seismic behavior, let's say if in the beams, if I'm getting excess local buckling, can you please mute? Yeah. So let's assume that it will be. I'm hearing echo. So in the beams, if you say that you have excess local buckling that is occurring, then how is the way that you can reduce the local buckling in the beams? Is like you have to use highly compact sections. Can anyone say in IS 800 code, how are we ensuring compact sections? If my beam section, somebody's unmuted themselves. Mute yourself.
Mr. Vijay Rathi, please mute yourself. Mr. Vijay Rathi. Mr. Vijay Rathi, please mute yourself.
Madam, can you mute him from your end?
So, okay, now I don't have any echo, so let's start. See, in moment resisting frame, you know that what you want as a favorable phenomena, but while having that favorable phenomena, there are chances that if you don't design your particular structure in the way it should be, you can expect certain early failure or premature failures to happen in your structure. So if we concentrate upon beam, what is the unfavorable behavior that you can expect is excessive local buckling can result in strength loss and ultimate fracture, which is associated with low cycle fatigue. Local buckling, as I said, can happen in a later stage when you are crossing 3% or 4% deformations, that is beyond in a severe condition that you are talking about in very localized places. But even then, at a premature stage, during the initial phases of yielding and all, you don't want that particular event to happen. So the way you can do is it, remedy is to using highly compact section and provision of lateral bracing in the zones of anticipated plastic injury. The red zones that I've shown earlier, where I said inelastic deformations are getting concentrated, we term it as a plastic hinge. Plastic hinge is an, is a convenience for us. Actually, the whole section in that particular zone where the face of the column will undergo yielding. So you can concentrate it at, as a particular thing. But while analysis, code allows you to take it as a concentrated plastic hinge. You must have seen heard this term. Ma'am, can you mute him, ma'am? Okay, so with respect to beam, that is how you can do. I'll come back to the compact section part. I'll come back to the code where it is given that this is how the compact section has to be provided. Where, how do we achieve that? Well, I'll let you know. If I come to the beam to column connection, yes, there are also failures that can occur in a connection, which is related to brittle fractures, fractures in highly strained base, fractures at weld access hole, end section fractures, shearing and tension failure of bolts, bolt bailing and block shear failures. So the remedy is CLB. Ma'am, can you do we have this number? Maybe you can call me.
Ruby, madam, can you please join me?
Hello.
Please join to the laptop and please remove Vijay Rathi.
Okay, so the benefit from that is that if there is a problem in beam to column connections, which obviously will be if you don't design it properly. So what even our code as well as international codes tells you is that if you have if you want to have a better behavior from the connections, you have to test it, you have to verify it, you have to create design procedures for it, and then you have to use it in your design. So that is where the remedy is to use pre-qualifying connections. In many of the Indian structures, people are using pre-qualified connections, which Americans have given in their that 350 AIC 358 code, and it is being used in Indian sections. There is a downfall for that, but still there needs to be testing which can avoid such kind of failures. In a moment resisting frame, there are only four components. There is a column, there is a beam, there is a connection, and there is a panel zone. Now, what we want is when we showed that red plastic hinging, or when we said the ideal behavior is that I want hinging to, or the inelastic deformation to happen in the beams and the base of the column. It is not a necessity, but there are two ways in which people design. One is a procedure in which you want even panel zones to yield and kind of reduce the demand that is coming on the beams. Or the other way is provide the panel zones to behave in an elastic manner and let the beam take care of itself. So what people have seen, that what research work has been done has shown, is that if you include the energy dissipation through panel zone, it slightly reduces the damage in the beams and the post-earthquake kind of repair work that you have to do. That is less in terms if you include the panel zone deformation also into account. But the problem that comes in, that if you look at the remedy in which you give stiffener plates as well as you give welding details and all, you control, people often neglect this particular part when it comes to the design. There is a provision for cover plate that is given in the software that you use in ETABS and all. There is a thing that comes in that, do you want to add a cover plate to that particular panel zone member? While designing, you add it, but during the execution part, you actually forget to bring that in. Means that numerical model that you have created considers that particular plate being given additional thickness to that panel zone. But while execution your design, you forget to design that particular panel zone. So what will happen during the earthquake? You have designed in terms of the panel zone yielding, but you have under-designed that particular panel zone there. So what will happen? The damage will now get concentrated in the panel zone rather than in the beam particular, wherever you want the plastic hinge to form. That will degrade the kind of performance that you expect from the moment resisting frame. In terms of columns, again the same, local buckling, lateral torsional buckling, global buckling, everything will be there. You have to find out what is the adequate axial strength ratio, adequate compactness ratio. This term compactness ratio plays a very important role in terms of steel structures. And in IS 800, I'll show you the table where we look after this particular compactness ratio. And then lateral bracing, wherever is possible, we have to give in terms of such kind of things. Okay. So column splices, again, this is where you have, when you're constructing a high-rise structures, your column length that you get from the manufacturer is of limited length. So you have to give column splices. So column splices is a connection which allows you to transfer the forces from the column to the next part of the column. So that has to be, dealt with in terms of same way in which you're talking about the connections. And then column bases, finally, where you take your steel column, you may put it on a base plate, and then that lies on a concrete pedestal. You have to look after the design that it does not fail. There is no pullout failure. There is no fracture in base plate. And such kind of things has to happen. This will come only through proper designing, testing and all has to come in. Our code has details regarding base plate and all, but many things are missing in it. I'll tell you where it comes from. So this is my first question to all of you, that response reduction factor for a special moment resisting frame is more than ordinary moment resisting frame. Will it translate into a low cost building or not? Now I'll explain you in terms of why this question has been put up, is that in our code as well as in international code, there is a distinction between special moment frames and ordinary moment frames. This is the same way we talk about in RCC structures. We differentiate between a special moment resisting frame RCC as well as an ordinary moment resisting frame in RCC. Can anyone tell me what is the difference in terms of RCC? Why we call it special and why we call it ordinary? Is there any difference in performance that is why we call it special, or is there something else that is making it special? Can anyone answer me? I mean, don't feel, don't hesitate in terms of answering. If you're wrong, you're wrong. That is okay. But please participate.
Sir, the quality is good.
Ductiles are special.
Special ductiling is the criteria. Quality in terms of, you have to take care in terms of ordinary moment resisting frame as well as quality of construction has to be there. But what ductile detailing that you have mentioned is the correct answer. We have IS 13920 that has been made specifically to achieve this special category for moment resistant frame, which is used in high seismic zone level so that you have better performance. Now, coming back to our answer, in terms of steel structure also, it is the same. For SMRF, there is a separate criteria that we have to satisfy in terms of by which we can use it in high seismic areas, because it is going to perform in a better way. Yes, like in RC structures, between special and ordinary, there is nothing different. It is the same that you are doing some kind of connection as well as design procedure in such a way that you achieve this particular distinction between special and ordinary. Now, coming back to this question, if I'll tell you, response reduction factor of an SMRF, a steel SMRF, comes out to be 5, the same as what is there for RCC, and that for OMRF comes out to be 3. So will it result into a low cost building? Yes, no, maybe. What can be your answer? If anyone can say the answer, I can then proceed.
Yes, sir. The building having lower response reduction factor will have more cost.
Why?
Because as the factor is lower, the design base shear which is going to come will be higher. And to design the structure for this higher base shear, high amount of steel or greater amount of steel or greater amount of metal might be required.
Yes, you are absolutely correct in terms of that quantification of base shear, that if I'm using a lower response reduction factor, so the way I calculate the seismic acceleration coefficient, that is the AH value, I do it by Z by 2, I by R, SA by G, where R is my response reduction factor. The lower the number, the higher the AH value will be there, and higher will be my base shear with respect to which I design the structure. So effectively, it's my ordinary moment resisting frame, which might be come out to be costlier, but there is a problem there. The problem is that in moment resisting frame, you have a problem that you have the drift criteria in many a times controlling the design. It is not the strength of the section which caters for the design. I mean, every time you design, okay, you look at what is the axial force, what is the flexure, what is the shear force coming into the structure, and you design the structure accordingly. But in a moment resisting frame, where you are depending upon the frame action to resist the forces, the lateral stiffness is less in terms of a moment frame. And many a times what happens is that to accommodate that drift limit, which drift limit? The elastic drift limit under lateral, which tells you, okay, yes, you have to go for H by 250 for the interstory drift ratio limit, which you have to give between intermediate floors. Interstory drift ratio should be limited to H by 250. You will find it in IS 1893 2016 part 1, where it tells limit that particular criteria. And many a times this moment resisting frame does not go into it. So you cannot say sometimes SMRF, when you come out to design that particular structure with lower this thing, when you do an analysis, you will find out that for lower forces, you will be designing, you will getting lesser sections, the lateral stiffness will be less. And due to satisfying the drift criteria, it happens so that the SMRF might come out to be more costlier than OMRF. So what you said in terms of quantity is fine, but in terms of when you look at the different design parameters that come into picture, so one thing is clear. Yes, SMRF is a better system, but it is having less lateral stiffness, and it happens to sometimes control the design of the structures. What else is coming into the design are, one is drift limits, P delta instabilities due to this less stiffness, you can expect P delta forces to be high. Strong column weak beam criteria also governs the design at times. If you are looking at, if you remember, the strong column weak beam criteria for RCC structures is given as 1.4. For steel structures, I mean 1.4 is given in 13920. In IS 800, this value is given as 1.2. But to satisfy that particular criteria, we have certain problems. Like you have your section. I mean, what I mean to say is that the section of column or beam that you design in a structure may be governed not just by strength, but maybe due to drift, due to P delta instability, due to strong column weak beam criteria. And again, this fact variable is coming, compactness limit. Again, this thing comes up. This is again and coming that this compactness is a very important factor. And the fifth criteria is the available sections. As per Indian Steel Design Code, what are the different sections that are available to me? That also governs the design particular thing. So what can I do if I'm having higher forces, higher moments that are coming? Yes, I can use deep, wide flange sections for columns, and I can maybe limit the bay width to kind of get a better performance. But use of deep, wide flange sections for columns may the problems may be ki architecturally you are losing out the livable space inside the building. Other than that, your compactness ratio may be up for a run. The problems are there. You cannot simply go and design a wide flange section or deep columns for your column member, because testing has most already those figures or those design values are mostly designed and checked with the experiments which are done on small sections. So you don't know how it is going to behave in a higher span way. And bay width ka, I mean, for a moment resisting frame, when you pick up a moment resisting frame and you go, what will be my bay width? What will be the lower end? What will be the higher? So a value in that is that key, if you use a bay width of 6 meter, less than 6 meter, the shear criteria is what is governing in comparison to the flexural criteria. So you want to avoid that particular range where the shear is getting the more governing criteria in terms of the design. So more than 6 is okay. But what is the upper limit? The upper limit currently in the construction industry is kept as 12 meters. Beyond 12, it becomes, what do you say, uneconomical. But 6 to 12 meter is the range where steel moment resisting frame bay width is currently set. You can go anywhere between them. But yeah, in India, 6 meter, if you have, it is better to go with RCC because cost-wise, I mean, I'm only talking about cost-wise when I say go with 6 meter ke liye, go with RCCs just because cost will be less. But the range is there. 12 meter steel will be a better option. Now, what is their lighter, shallower section and their connection that meets core compactness requirement tend to have large inelastic deformation desirable? I mean, I have given these PPTs to madam, so you can all go through it at a later point. We have to. So these are all providing how can I improve the performance. Now, I'll tell you one thing that in India, there is a practice that for moment resisting frame, you can give each frame to be a moment resisting frame. But in America, what they do is they only allow the peripheral frames to be the ones that act as the moment resisting frame. Rest interior ones are only gravity frames. So in terms of India, we have larger redundancy in terms of number of frames which are resisting the lateral forces. In America, the redundancy is less. But what they have is much better in terms of the number of available sections that they have, the number of sections which are satisfying the compactness ratio that they have. And because of these available sections and which satisfy this criteria, they tend to get a better kind of bargain with respect to what they are doing. So just before we come to that compactness criteria thing, just want to tell you something that when we talk about drift in a moment resisting frame, yes, we are talking about shear drift as well as flexural drift. There are two components that you have to remember. Based on what is the configuration, bay width as well as height of your structure, the dimension of the structures, either one will be governing in terms of the final drift value which you are giving into this thing. In flexural drift, you know, the by looking at that particular diagram, it is the axial deformation of the columns which are contributing to that type of a drift. And in shear drift, it is the deformation in the beams or the flexural, the contribution from the beam which is governing that thing. So in your structure, if you have higher flexural drift, obviously you will go for increasing the size of the peripheral, the exterior columns on the left and right side, so that you have a better behavior in terms of that. Okay, we'll come to in terms of that. So this is the main slide that I want to talk to you. You have all seen this particular figure, right? In terms of selection of cross section, or how do you select the member in terms of whether being used as a beam or a column, you have seen this classification, right? Plastic, compact, semi-compact and slender, right? Which type of section is the worst one in this?
Slender section, sir.
Correct. And the best one is obviously the plastic one. So our code actually directs you. We'll come to the code classification also, is that in a plastic section, yes, after yielding of the member, the member has enough capacity to reach its plastic moment capacity. And beyond that, it is having rotational capacity. Beyond, after reaching MP also, it is having adequate amount of rotational capacity in it, so that it is classified as a plastic section. And in a SMRF, you need at these plastic hinge locations at least sections which are plastic in nature, so that it can yield, it can deform in its inelastic and have enough capacity to safeguard all the other members and dissipate energy while it is doing so. Okay. So how to achieve ductile behavior is that you have to have level of compactness required for beam and column members should be achieved. frame members should be laterally braced for stability. When we say laterally braced, is that you have heard about deep beams. When you have a span of 12 meter, you will obviously end up with a deep beam. In that deep beam, if you don't laterally brace that particular beam, there is a problem that it can undergo lateral torsion buckling and all. So you want lateral bracing to be provided to those beams. And then to achieve next, the ductile behavior is the strong column weak beam criteria. You have to achieve 1.2 to satisfy that particular criteria. And again, with respect to demand critical welds, like when if you're doing a CJP welding at a particular connection region, you have to be thoroughly knowing what should you do, what should be the welding process that you should go for. If your plate thickness is more than 50 mm, you should go for a preheating practice of that particular plate so that you avoid fracture or minute cracks occurring in that particular weld locations. Then you have designated protected zones. Now, this is important in terms key. Indian practices does not look at designated protected zone as such as a term. You won't find this term in our Indian code. Protected zones, what we mean by that is that the locations where you expect the plastic hinges to form or the yielding of the beams, I mean, those locations where yielding is going to happen, we should protect those zones in terms of nothing encroaches on that particular area of the beam. There should not be any separate connection in that location. There should not be any cutout or something made for any duct to go through that particular location. That location should be a strict no-go zone for any type of different constructional activity other than that what it has been designed for. Now, next thing is shear yielding of panel zone is a very ductile behavior. However, accompanying shear deformation can impose potentially harmful secondary stresses. So if you are going for that balanced design of that panel zone where you want yielding of the panel zone to happen, you have to look for a similar kind of design procedure to go for it. And best inelastic behavior of beam column connection is obtained when limited yielding occurs in the panel zone simultaneously with beam plastic hinging. So behavior, the best behavior of a moment resisting frame is hinging occurs in the beams at the base of the columns with limited yielding in the panel zones and maybe no yielding or nothing happening in the connections. If you want the connections also to have some kind of energy dissipation, you have to test it before you use it. Okay. And finally, the doubler plate or continuity plate is with respect to what you give at the panel zone. If you want to avoid shear buckling of that particular panel zone, you give doubler plate at that location. If you want to avoid the column web to not buckle from the forces that comes from the beam flanges, you give continuity plate. So these are the kind of practices that we go for. Now, if I consider this as my moment resisting frame, a plan of a building is here. I have given locations for the columns at these locations. And you have an elevation like this. All stories are 3.6 meter high. So if I'm going to design a moment resisting frame from here, what does our code currently say? The code says for ordinary moment resisting frame, 0.02 radians is what you have to achieve without any kind of major failure happening in the structure. Just achieve 0.02%, which is corresponding to 2% of interstory drift ratio. Whereas in case of special moment resisting frame, it is telling go for 0.04 radians or 4% drift in terms of achieving a better performance. While doing that, use only E250 kind of grade of steel. Now, I want your attention here is that IS 2062-2011 is a code that is currently being used to classify our material grade. When we talk about reinforcement bar, we talk about Fe450, Fe500, Fe550 and all. But in terms of structural steel, we use the terms E250, E350, E450 and all grades are there. So that reference, what will be the percentage elongation or minimum yield stress or the maximum strength of that particular member, that we'll get from this IS 2062 code. So what in special moment resisting frame, it says achieve 0.04 radians of joint rotation while using E250 grade of steel. Now, where should we use these structures? Ordinary moment resisting frame should not be used in seismic zones 4 and 5. And for buildings with important factors greater than 1, it should not be used in seismic zone 3. But special moment resisting frame, you can use any in any zones. There is no issue with respect to for any importance factor value. You can use it as you wish because it behaves in much better way. And in terms of connection, the rigidity of the connection in an ordinary moment resisting frame can be rigid or semi-rigid. An annexure in IS code tells you what you call as a rigid and what you not call as a, I mean, what you call as a semi-rigid connection. So they are allowing you to use semi-rigid and rigid connection in an ordinary moment resisting frame, but is not allowing semi-rigid to be there in SMR, which should be rigid at all times. That is what they are telling you to do that. Now, the other thing is that, okay, in terms of what you see here, this is the thickness of the panel zone, so such that you can avoid the buckling of the panel zone that has been given there. And additionally, what under what load design you should design your panel zones and all has been given in the code with respect to what is OMRF and SMRF. With respect to SMRF, this is where this particular equation has been given, where you check the flexural capacity of the beam section, flexural capacity of the column section joining at a particular joint, and you want that particular ratio of columns to be higher higher by 1.2. Now, the issue here is our Indian code does not divulge more than this. But what you should understand is that the flexural capacity of a beam and the flexural capacity of a column is little bit different in terms of, if you consider the column flexural capacity, for instance, the axial load which acts on a member. I mean, for a three-story, six-story structure, this might not be a problem. But when you go to a nine-story structure, let's say I'm talking about the ground floor column, the axial force in that column will be very high. You know that due to axial force, the flexural capacities will have some change, will have some impact. So in US code and all, if you see, they tell you to take care of the axial load effect into the calculation of this particular thing. Another factor that we miss in our code is that, you know, we always design with respect to the nominal value of the steel. You buy an E250 grade, you understand that 250 is the yield stress. That is the nominal value that is mentioned there. But when you do a coupon testing, like you do tension testing of a coupon sample in a UTM, you find that nominal value, say, you get a higher value. Can anyone tell me what is the problem? I mean, is it good if I test a steel grade, which is of a particular grade? Let's say my yield stress is 215. I do a coupon test and I find out that my 250 MPa. I do a coupon testing and I find that the yield stress is actually 300. Is it a good thing or a bad thing? Can anyone tell me? Is it a good thing to have higher value of yield stress after I do a coupon test?
No, sir. No, sir.
Why can you define?
If it yields more, then it will go to plastic state.
Mm-hmm. So I'm getting higher strength. I mean, the first one will yield at 250. I mean, nominal value, if I see of the member, it will yield at 250. But I'm having a material which is yielding at 300. Give me that result. What could be the problem if I get a higher yield stress?
Distress.
Huh? Stress means?
Distress, sir.
Distress. Okay. Let me say it in this way. If I'm designing a building where there is no earthquake coming, and if I'm designing the structure for gravity loads only, I will be in an advantageous position. I'll be in advantageous position because for the same amount of load, I can use very less amount of material in terms of designing the structure. But if you look at in a way, I mean, in that case, getting 300 out, expected value of the yield stress, getting 300 out of a E250 material is good. I'm happy with it. Very good. But in terms of earthquake performance, if you look, if I'm calculating this ratio 1.2, and it happens so that the material that I've used for column is some other grade, let's say E350. Right now, our code does not allow you to use that. It says E250 throughout. But let's say in E250 itself, I've used some batch of material for my column and some other batch for beam. There is a chance that the expected value of yield stress in the beam might be more than what is there for the column that at that particular joint. So in that case, there is a remote possibility that you might end up with a weak column, strong beam kind of scenario. So in a lateral load case, where earthquake you are designing in a high seismic region and all, where you're designing your structure for earthquake forces, this particular expected value and the range, I mean the difference between expected and nominal, can create problems for you. So it is not always good to have a higher value. So that is what this particular question is coming to. Now RBS, you can see a beam section here, right? This is a question there for you. This is a column section and this is a beam section. Now can you tell me what is strange here?
Sir, the possibility of formation of the plastic hinge in the beam is most probable. So means we are more sure that the hinge will be
correct.
Yeah.
Correct. What you have said is correct. We're talking about this figure only, right? So before I explain to you this diagram, you can see a steel plate here, right? Which has been added as a stiffener to the column. This is what we call as a continuity plate. So when the beam is undergoing flexure, you can expect loads are there. So you can expect the flanges to give tension as well as compressive forces to the web of the column. So unless and until you have designed the web of the column is not enough, you may have to provide continuity plates to avoid the buckling of the web of the column. That is why you give a continuity plate here. The other plate, the doubler plate, ka meaning ye hota hai ki this panel zone on top of the web of the column itself, you paste a plate on either side, on both sides of the column, you provide such that the panel zone, when this particular beam, a moment is being transferred to the column, if you look at the panel zone depth, a kind of shear force is transmitted. If you divide that moment by that lever arm, the distance between that particular continuity plate, that location will have shear force induced in them. So to avoid shear buckling, you provide doubler plate on top of that. Now what you see here in this figure, you see a kind of dog bone shape, kind of the flange has been cut in a dog bone kind of a shape. This is what you call as an reduced beam section. AIC 358, which is made for pre-qualified connections, also has a connection. I mean, this is a pre-qualified connection that is there, which is a reduced beam section. What it does is that if you have designed this particular area in such a way that the moment capacity of this particular section is less, so when the real forces during an earthquake, when it comes, you know that the plastic hinge will, you are making that plastic hinge to form here by making this particular of a lower strength. Issue is that while making this particular section of lower strength, you are putting in more money into the area here. You don't want any kind of inelasticity to happen, so there are some cost issues there. If steel is less costlier in your country, yes, you may go for an RBS section, but you can see how it is going to perform, that the plastic hinging or the inelasticity is concentrated in this area, safeguarding your connection. The more brittle kind of failure is being avoided, and safeguarding even your panel zone. The panel zone is showing some amount of yielding and all. So that is also putting, I mean, if my beam was more elastic, the onus on dissipating the energy would either go to the panel zone or to the connection. Now, if you have maintained a hierarchy between who is going to be the weakest link, I mean, ductile designing, if you remember capacity design, if you have learned from somewhere, always a link, a chain of links is shown. So the weakest link, you want to be the most ductile one, so that the other members, which are having brittle failure nature, are safeguarded the most way. So that is the same policy that being done here in terms of our design. In our IS 800, the way we do strong column weak beam is a capacity design formula that we are putting in. It is nothing related to limit state. We are trying to focus the damage to happen in the beams rather than in columns. That is where strong column weak beam has come in. Same way, if you design, bring in a hierarchy between the design of your panel zone and connections, our beam will be the first one to yield. But what is happening in our case is that there is a difference in the yield to expected value. Our code designates that. How do you design your connections and panel zones? You design it for 1.0 times the plastic moment section capacity of the beam. So what happens is that 1.2 MP is the value with which you design your connections and panel zones. You're designing with the same factor to design your panel zones and connections. So I don't know which one will go first in terms of connection and panel zone. But the next problem is 1.2 MP, I have said. MP is what? Fi into plastic section modulus. That Fy is itself is a question mark. If I take 250 and design panel zone and connection, and what if that 250 becomes 350 as the expected value, there again the problem occurs. So that is what you got to take care of. You have to always remember, till that answer comes, you have to remember that there is a problem, that if you are doing a project in steel structures, you have to get samples of coupons tested out of those members, test them to know what is their nominal value, what is their expected value, and then make a decision on how you want to design your panel zones, connections, beams and columns. Now, you, every one of you must have seen this particular book, right? SP6, which we use for designing our structural members, deciding which sections to go for. You must have, has anyone seen this particular code? IS12778. There are two codes available in terms of selection of sections for beam and column sections. SP6 is for tapered I sections, and IS12778 is for parallel flange sections, which means there is no, if you look at our I section, you can see there is a taper in the flange. I mean, your edge of that flange of the beam is less thicker than what is at the face of that web. So that is what we call as a taper. But in America, US, this particular practice is followed, that they use parallel flange. It's absolutely, there is no tapering in that section. So Indian code in 12778 talks about parallel flange sections. Now, can anyone tell me what is the maximum depth of I section, rolled I section? Means no built up, there is no built up case coming up. In these codes, SP6 and 12778 are available in the market. What is the deepest I section that you can get, rolled I section? Can anyone tell me? Maximum depth of beam section?
600 mm.
Okay. 600. Correct. That was the case before 12778 came in. These are the instances which gives me inspiration to teach more about steel structure, is that the value is 900 mm. We have deeper beam sections that are available. If you look at this particular 12778 code, it gives you narrow parallel flange beam sections as well as wide parallel flange beam sections, which go up to a depth of 900. In US, the maximum depth is 1100 something is there. We have reached 900 mm. So that 600 was what, with respect to SP6, what we used to learn and all, ISMB 600 was the maximum. But from this particular code is back in 2004, this has come out. So sections with 900 depth was available from 2004 itself, this was available, but not many people are aware of it. So next time when you go for a beam section, don't go for a built up section, go for a rolled steel section. You don't have anything to worry about the welding details that you're provided in a built up section once you go for a rolled beam section. But what is the problem? Is it that easy that you can, now that you have 900 sections, we come to the most important part of our discussion, that limiting, this is the table 2 of IS 800-2007, which relates to the compactness ratio. This is where when we say dividing our sections into, classifying our sections into whether they are plastic, semi-compact, compact or slender, we have this table being given. This is mostly for flexural members. You can refer to AISC code AISC 34116 in terms of axial members. I mean, compression brace members which undergo cyclic loading, you have to refer to that. That is not given in this. But for flexural members, everything is given here. So the issue is, now you are designing a special moment resisting frame, let's say in high seismic zone, let's say seismic zone 4, 5 and maybe 3 also. The code says use E250. Next, it says with E250, check the compactness ratio such that you know that in a high seismic region, you will have stringent guidelines for achieving compactness ratio. So what will you do? You have to design your sections. Now, with the available sections, if you see there are 65 sections, if I say for a beam that is available in SP61, and there are 192 sections available in 12778. I mean, there are large data pool is there in terms of data pool, section pool that is there in terms of designing a steel structures. Number of plastic section in terms of SP6, out of 65, only 28 classify as plastic sections. And number of plastic sections in comparison to 192, there are 132 sections which classify as plastic sections. So what is the issue? Now, if I calculate as per drift criteria, as per strength criteria, as per strong column, big beam criteria, if I satisfy even everything, there is a chance that if my requirement of section modulus is somewhere around 2000 mm cube, what will happen is that I will not find a section very close to that. That is the problem that Indian code right now faces, is that the sections which are there in the code, you might have to go for a 2500 or 2600 mm cube kind of a section, which again increases your problem. See, if you're designing a beam and you're not getting ample amount of sections to put in your structure, you're going for a deeper, heavier kind of a section for a beam, you automatically know that then I have to again satisfy strong column, weak beam. To achieve again that particular thing, I have to increase my structure. So that is where economy can be brought in our steel structures, is that, yes, if we can get more section sizes in terms of the available, which are plastic enough that can be used in SMRF for high seismic regions, then it is good enough to go for. I mean, if you're designing an OMRF, yes, go ahead, go and do it. I think Tamil Nadu mostly comes in zone 3, right? So if your structure is maybe a single story, a double story, maybe steel structure might be a better option. But yes, cost aside, cost is one major aspect there in terms of how you want to achieve that. But industrial structure, yes, you can easily go for a steel structure in terms of that. Now, what I'll do here is for beam design, what and all you have to take care of, I'll just leave it here. These are texts that I've given here. You seek the PPT and see, read. We'll have to go into many other things also. So these are things that you have to look for in terms of beam design. Now, this is the thing that I was taking, how to provide lateral bracing for the beams in terms of deep beams to avoid lateral torsional buckling. Yes, this has to be given, but yes, it has to be avoided at the protected zones, but at the other locations you have to provide. These are examples of how you can do that particular lateral bracing in the beams. In column design, again, I have given the factors by which you can get a better performance out of the column and the panel zone I have given. Now, let's come to this. Do you see any problem in this with respect to what we have discussed till now? Do you see any problem with this? Can anyone tell me what is the problem, or there is no problem? Okay, tell me that there is no problem. Anyone? What type of a connection is this, first of all? We had just mentioned the name for this.
Sir, shear connection.
No.
RBS?
Yes, RBS is the term I'm looking at, but this is not a shear connection because it is having a joint penetration weld at here and this location. But this is a shear connection here because you can see a gap between the flanges. They are not trying to transfer the moment here. You can see no weld lines here, but you can see a weld line here. So this is a moment connection and an RBS one. So what is the issue? Can you pinpoint and tell me? I'm talking about only this particular region. What is the problem? Here I want to say that when you say a protected zone, I was mentioning this protector. Here the protected zone is this area. This is where you expect your plastic hinge to happen. We have seen some numerical simulations where you can see that plastic hinge is going to happen here. This particular structure that you see here, this is part of the deck, the slab that is being cast. Now, somehow what they have done is they have supported it at the location where it should have been a protected zone and where it should not have been supported at all. I mean, even at the location where, you know, normally how do you support a deck sheet is that you have shear keys that are given at the top of the beam. At the location of protected zone, you should not even give a shear key. Why? Because when you have load reversal, you will get an asymmetric hysteresis curve, because in the in one direction you will have composite action of the slab as well as the beam acting as a more stronger and highly deformable section, but in the opposite side when it is deforming in the other direction, you won't get any kind of relation from the slab that is there. So it will be highly asymmetric, so you don't want any connections there. So what the problem here is, the connection in the protected zone is the problem here. You should not give such kind of practice here. Now, either aap bata sakta hai what kind of connection? I mean, there is no problem here, but what type of connections do you see here? both the connections.
Seated connections?
No, I'm asking with respect of rigidity, whether which one is the moment connection and which one is the shear connection.
Sir, the left one is a moment, sir.
Correct.
Yes,
sir. And the right one?
Sir,
can you see a gap in between the flanges of the beams and
sir?
Ideally, right now only the beam web has been connected to this particular stiffener plate here, or the gusset plate here. So, what would you call such type of a connection?
Flexible
or shear type of connection, simple connection. So, but what I want you people to understand is that moment connection is fine. I have no issues with that. End plate with stiffener that has been provided. But you must understand that even with these bolts that are given here, this beam is going to transfer some amount of forces to the section. Now, if you have a deeper beam, if you are going for 12 meter span, your column right now, this particular rigid connection is being done with respect to the major axis of the column. This particular beam is getting attached. But what you look at here is this particular beam with the shear connection is currently done in minor axis. It is attaching to the, it will produce moments about the minor axis of the column. The issue is okay if your beam depth is less. This thing is good enough. The way people design it in office is that they provide minor axis wala jo beam section, beam ka end hai, they provide it as a moment release. But while designing it, they provide a shear connection, thinking that it will not transfer any moment. But you have a deeper beam. Let's think about 600, 700, 1100 mm depth ka built up beam banata hai, and you give these kind of shear connections between them, it will transfer some substantial amount, not full MP. You won't be transferring whole plastic moment capacity of the beam, but you will include some amount of substantial amount of moment into this thing. So assuming a moment release in the beam section in a software model, but designing a shear connection for a deep beam in a real project, you have to think twice before you do that. Right now, there are no studies with respect to what will be with respect to our steel section, but you will find out research papers where minor axis ko bhi rigid connection, they were trying to make it as a rigid connection, and other places where what to do if you're connecting a beam to a minor axis of a column section. Now, I'll quickly go through this. This is a splice connection, as you can see. What you have to take care here is that there is no additional plate or a cover plate or a stiffener plate or some kind of cover plate which is given. Here it is solely dependent upon a complete joint penetration weld. If you don't do proper inspection and check for any weld defect in this particular joining of these two sections, this is normally okay. Normally okay in the sense they have done the right job. Without giving additional plates and all, if they are okay with the design, if the demand is less, this might be okay. But weld is something where inspection is very difficult in the sense that, yes, there are dye test method, there are ultrasonic pulse velocity test method that you do. But even if you do that, you will find out that there are some flaws. Welding is a kind of process which produces defects. Micro cracks can be there. And unless you test this kind of sections, if somebody comes up to you with this particular type of connection, you should say, prove me that this has shown such kind of rotational capability. Code says 0.02 radians for OMRF. It says 0.04 SMRF. Prove to me that this is satisfying that criteria through test or simulations. Then only I'll agree to this particular thing functioning. Otherwise, leave it. So these nuances you have to take care. Now, our code, there is a problem everything is there to improve. So I'm not blaming our code. Whatever has been made before has to be improved by the new generation. So with respect to that, what the code, the current IS 800-2007, it tells how, it says, what do you call as a simple connection? That shear connection that we mentioned earlier. It says, what do you call as a simple connection? As well as what do you call as a rigid connection? It is not telling anything else. How will you design it or how will you achieve it? It's not telling in that code there. But in annexure F of IS 800, it is telling, okay, the moment rotation relationship of connections have to be determined based on experiments conducted for the specific design or based on relationship derived from the test. So our code tells you the right guidance that don't go blindly into a connection if somebody comes to you. Either they pick it from the 358 code, AIC 358 code, and prove that with Indian materials it is working fine, or they come up with directly with the connection experiment and say, yes, this is the fine thing to go about with. And our code tells, okay, when do you call in terms of strength? When do you call as a rigid connection? When do you call as a rigid connection in terms of stiffness and all, in terms of rotational capability? It tells you how to classify them as these three. And a graph is also given in terms of, if you look at a connection, test it, you get its behavior, you can classify it as a rigid, semi-rigid, or a flexible. Understand that the connection might start as a rigid while its inception. When earthquake happens, there will be some damages or something that is happening. So from rigid, it might slip into semi-rigid. It might slip into flexible also. So that is the problem, that we have to test it, not in the elastic range. You know, in an elastic range, you can load the end of the beam and check whether the connection is giving you the right amount of strength or not. It is important to learn its cyclic behavior, inelastic deformation behavior, to understand whether it is functioning good or not. So these are the connections which have been already tested, pre-qualified. You can look at it in AIC 358-16. There are 9 to 12 connections which have been already pre-qualified. Some are proprietary. You have to pay some fund to actually use it in your structure, but some are free. They have been tested by American agencies and they can be used in our structures. Remember, don't go blindly. For Indian material, the variation in expected and yield value has to be taken into considerations, as well as the connection, the way welding is being done, or the grade of bolts that we use. Those also have to be tested before we come up with. We cannot go blindly with what they have done. But yes, design procedure, testing procedure, everything is there. 358 gives you connection design. Testing procedure you can find in 341-16 code. I mean, there are three codes: 360, which is equivalent to IS 800, 341, which is there earthquake ke liye. There is a specific code for steel structural design. We don't have such separate one. Ours is IS 800 combining both, and there is this particular code for connection, and ours is still IS 800 for that. Now, before we proceed on to concentrically braced frames and other types of frames, is this acceptable? What is shown in the figure is plastic hinge mechanism that has been formed in a bay of a moment resisting frame. Let's call it SMRF for the time being. Is it acceptable to you?
Sir, not acceptable, sir.
Why?
Because there is a hinge in like column side, in vertical direction. So that is cause serious problem, sir.
No, but column method acceptable tha. When we talked, when we said the beam.
Yes, sir, beam to end, and it should be in beam, sir. Like it should be in beam corner, sir.
But when I mentioned in columns, I said column may be acceptable. But can you tell me the location where I said it is acceptable?
Sir, column.
Sir, it was in top, that sir, it is acceptable in at the bottom.
Correct. Though you want the hinge to be formed at the base of the column rather than at any intermediate stage. Why? Because if you have hinges in the columns that are being formed, there is a high probable case that you can end up having story mechanism up. Soft story, you must have read about and saw soft story failure of structures where you have infill on top and bottom stiffness is less. So the hinging mechanism there will be top and bottom column hinges. It forms, and finally the soft story mechanism forms and the structure collapses. So you don't want that to happen while having hinges at the other force of the structure. Beams is okay. Column, it should be always at the base of the column. Nowhere else it is required. Is this acceptable? Think and tell me. It is the similar figure. We have established the fact that, yes, I want the hinges at the base of the column. Is this acceptable or not?
Sir, not acceptable, sir, because it should be in just corner, sir. It should be behind corner, sir. It is some little distance, sir.
No, that is okay. See, there is another whole chapter where we talk about where the hinges should be. If you are going for a lumped plastic hinge approach, there are different approaches. Fiber hinge approach is there, lumped plastic hinge approach is there. Lumped plastic means you are cutting at a section and telling this is where the hinge should be. let us say that the location of the hinge is currently fine at the base of the column.
Maybe no, sir. Because so what is the problem? Sir, fixed support must be there, sir. Then only.
No, why? Why fixed support should be there to have hinges? I'll explain it to you. It's a bit tricky here. I mean, I kept it for a purpose that, see, first you have to understand when we say plastic hinges, our focus is on plastic hinges, but we are not thinking why plastic hinge at first place. Why there is inelastic deformation, what and all ways in which our first focus should be, how does a moment frame fail? It can happen due to flexural failure of beam, it can happen due to shear failure of beam, it can happen due to axial load moment interaction of column, it can happen due to shear failure of column, or it can be something else of shear moment interaction, which is newer area in which people are moving into. But currently everyone is like, okay, I'm happy with a moment hinge in the beam and an axial moment hinge interaction hinge in the column. It is correct that, yes, if I draw a pinned support at the bottom, I'm not expecting moment to happen there. So what else is the way the column can fail there? The other possible way can be a shear failure of the column. So if I say a shear failure that has happened there, it's a strict no-no. So this is not an acceptable thing. If you have a base fixed, like in the last case, you expect moment, axial force, everything to be high there, and mostly aapka base shear, story shear is increasing. When you look at story shear and you calculate the base shear by cumulatively adding up all the story shear, you find that the maximum value at the base. So that is why you expect that hinge to form at the base of the columns. But now when you have a pinned column, pinned base at the bottom, and you are getting a hinge there, which means it's not a flexural hinge, you don't have any moment there. So you are not supposed to have any moment there. That is how you have to construct that structure, but you are getting a hinge there. It must be something else. So it is a brittle failure. So you don't want anything to happen there. Clear? Now let us move to another type of a passive device. Now in this is a special concentrically braced frame. Now you can see there is a beam, there is a column, there is a brace here. If I remove the brace, it is a moment resisting frame. If I add the brace and center lines are all matching, it's coincidental and everything, it is a concentrically braced frame. These are different variations. This is a mega brace frame covering a lot more floors. And this is the normal chevron type of a brace. There are different brace configurations that can come in. Here, the logic is different. What we want from a concentrically braced frame is that hamare ghar mein, we have a fuse there in our house, right? If you have extra heavy load of current that is coming in, you have a fuse that is built into it such that it trips and it safeguards the rest of your appliances and everything. Same way, we want our brace to act as a fuse in the system. It is a sacrificial element, which means we want it to die. In literal sense, we want it to get damaged during an earthquake. And by doing that, we want it to save the beams and columns. So you can understand that if I have a brace in the structure, we will make it the most ductile as well as the weakest member in our structure. It is based on, from here on, what you say is we are using capacity design ka direct principle. We are not using limit state method to design these structures. We are going for capacity based design where we are saying strength wise brace is the weakest. Stronger than them are beams and columns. But when I say weakest member, the brace should be ductile enough in a way that when it is undergoing inelastic deformation and taking up all of the energy dissipation process into it in its own end, it should not fail prematurely. But the problem here is, the way it undergoes inelastic deformation is through tension yielding of the brace as well as brace buckling. Now, when we talk to people, when you say we want buckling to happen in the brace, people say buckling is the last thing that you would want. Us hisab se to buckling is the worst behavior to have in a structure. It will not undergo any yielding. It might undergo elastic buckling and everything else will happen due to that. Failure will happen due to that. So what we want to say here is, if you can look at this particular hysteresis curve, what you see about the zero axis is the tension axis, means the amount of energy that I get dissipated through tension yielding of the brace is very high. But if you can see the buckling load, 46 kilonewton, after it reaches in the initial cycle, the first thing that happens is the buckling of the brace in compression. there is a drastic reduction in the energy dissipation capacity of the braces, and this is the foremost disadvantage of the CBF structure. Even though it safeguards, the problem is the hysteresis curve is asymmetric, which means in one way, when the earthquake is coming, there will be heavy energy dissipation from the brace if it is undergoing tension. But when the earthquake happens, I mean, when the ground motion pushes the structure in the opposite direction, the same brace will undergo buckling. And then what will happen is that it will dissipate very less energy. So what is the easiest solution to rectify that is to use mirror images of these braces. Iske side mein, I can have another bay where the brace is inclined in this direction. But because the buckling phenomena as it happens, see, every time we say buckling should buckling happen should. Means I'm not advocating on the basis of the braces and saying buckling is a good behavior. No, buckling is not a good behavior. If there was no buckling in the brace, you would have got equal energy at the compression side also. But this is one of the passive devices. This has got improved into buckling restrained brace frame. But initially, when people used it, they said, okay, to negate this particular buckling and reduced amount of energy that is dissipated, let's go for a brace in this direction also, which means in one direction, one brace will be in tension, and the other direction, the other brace will be in tension. And let's do one more thing. Rather than using very slender brace sections, let's go for thicker and stout sections in terms of brace, as that even this value, even this 40.6 that you're getting here, this is a larger value. And there is no elastic buckling, then let's go for, even if I'm getting energy there, let's go for a thicker and stouter section so that I can get higher stiffness, because I'm using a thicker section means I'm getting higher stiffness. Lateral stiffness will be very high in terms of these sections. So the strength to weight ratio as well as the stiffness to weight ratio is highest in terms in comparison to moment frames as well as in buckling restraint frames also. This particular CBF structure is having higher stiffness than both of them. But this asymmetric response in terms of buckling happening is a disadvantage for this structure. So what and all affects the performance of a brace frame is that, yes. So now you know, this is the sacrificial element. Rest of the beams and columns should remain almost elastic. Under DB condition, it should be design basis earthquake ka. Matlab, if I say DBE, under that, it should be beams and columns should be mostly elastic. So every responsibility in terms of mitigating the earthquake forces falls on the brace. So you know where the critical parameters would be located at. You're not looking at beams and columns. You're looking at the brace itself. Brace may, so what is the important characteristics? Yes, slenderness ratio. Most important parameter there. If your slenderness ratio is high, your energy dissipation is low. Why? Because if slenderness ratio is high, your buckling mein jitna compression mein, the amount of energy that is dissipated is going to be low. Theek hai? And if your slenderness ratio is small, I mean, think in terms ki, when I say slenderness ratio is high and low, you're looking at a frame where your bay width is, let's say, 10 meters, your story height is, say, 3.6 meter. You have a fixed length. In a fixed length, if I say I want higher slenderness ratio, and if I want to say have a lower slenderness ratio, I'm playing only with the thickness of the member. So you can understand when I say lower slenderness ratio, I'm getting higher energy means I'm using a thicker section in terms of to achieve that. In terms of compactness ratio, fir se, wohi jo humne B by TW, H by TW, jo table 2 of IS 800 dekha tha, same problem yahan pe hai ki agar aapka compactness ratio, agar maan lo brace ke liye normally hollow pipe, hollow circular pipe, hollow rectangular pipe, hollow square pipe ya I section jate hain. In terms of, if you look at all those four cross sections, the compactness ratio will be either outer diameter to thickness ratio or rectangle ka depth to thickness ratio or the I sections flange width to thickness ratio or web depth to thickness ratio. So if you are going a larger value, you can expect local buckling to happen prematurely in such sections where compactness ratio is high. But if you limit it under a certain level, which is not given in our code, but is given in 341, you can refer to that. That will allow you to have a better, energy dissipation from the brace member. Then again, cross-sectional shapes. If you go for, the easiest way to connect a rectangular or a hollow square brace to a gusset plate is by cutting a slit in the hollow square and circular brace and inserting the gusset plate inside that. It is very easy. But in a circular pipe section, it is difficult. How will you determine the center line? How will you determine that your gusset plate is not acting eccentrically to the brace section that you have attached. There is a problem there. I section, again, there is a problem of connecting the I section to the gusset plate. You have to cut a slit in the web, but then minor axis buckling might happen. In most cases, minor axis is what is happening. So you will get less amount of energy from there. So what has been developed from research is that sections, shapes which are square and rectangular undergo premature fracture due to early fracture due to this local buckling happening in its cross section. Whereas circular is better than square and rectangular hollow sections, and I sections is even better than that. So if you can solve the connection problem, you would rather would go for an I section rather than a hollow rectangular or a square. But if your demand is not so high, you don't want to go for an I section. Yes, built up is out of question, because then eccentricity and all those constructional tolerances, you cannot manage it in using built up section. So better go for a pipe section for that. And then lesser amount of impacting parameters like loading rate. You fill the hollow sections with cement, you get a better behavior. Loading history with respect to near field earthquake and far field earthquake, there is a difference in the demand that comes on the braces. Effect of boundary conditions, you want to give a rigid boundary condition, you want to give a flexible one. How is it going to be used? How is it going to behave? And lower grade of steel, you can go for E250, 350, 450. The behavior is going to be different. Same way we say higher grade steel has less amount of ductility. Same problem with this. Now, same way as we have talked about SMRF and OMRF, there is a classification of SCBF and OCBF, special concentrically braced frames and ordinary concentrically braced frames, with the same guidelines like, okay, SCBF has to be used in high seismic regions and all, and this has to be used in low seismic regions, OCBF. Now, with respect to certain configurations that has been shown here, the code does not, this is not our code, this is as per US code, because Hamara code, SCBF is actually restricted in section 12 onto just 5 or 8 clauses. Nothing more is given there. So you have to look for literature outside your scope in terms of designing these structures. So I'm just giving an introduction to here is, there are certain configurations that are good and is recommended by the international court to be used in special concentrically braced frame, that is in high seismic regions. But certain configurations are a strict no-no. You can use them maybe in OCBF, but not in a SCBF location, not a high seismic location. Why? Because here you can see this particular junction is coming at the mid of the column. So there will be some demand due to this particular brace hitting at this location. This particular configuration, you know, you have only one brace coming in and hitting. There is a problem there. You cannot live with that. I mean, you can only have tension forces getting this thing. So you have to have used some mirror image kind of construction you have to go for. The third one is a kink type of thing. This particular structure is given that will again produce forces on the columns. Now, there is one more problem. Even when I say this particular thing, when earthquake is in, let's say it acts in this direction, you have tension in this brace, you have compression in this brace. Agar mera ye buckle kar jata hai and this is at its yielding location, this beam will be subjected to horizontal as well as vertical forces. So there is two stages, pre-buckled stage and post-buckled stage. In the post-buckled stage, the amount of forces in the tension brace will be very higher and the compression brace will be very low. So there will be an unbalanced vertical force, a very high force that is acting in it. So the code recommends to design your beam section for that unbalanced section in configurations like these. This is called as a chevron or an inverted V type of a construction, and this is called as a V type kind of a bracing member. So in this type, you have to take care. So what people, I mean, if you have such a problem, the best solution is to go for this. So when you have an unbalanced thing, you have these two braces to take care of it. But yes, there are problems. What if the upper one is undergoing buckling as well? Because when the earthquake is acting from left to right, you have this whole brace undergoing compression and you have this whole brace undergoing tension. So you have to do a proper analysis before you design. So how do we design? Before design, let us come to modes of failure. Okay. So as we said, when we look at a structure or structural system like moment frame, we need to know what is good for us and what is bad for us, the performance. There we said hinging in beams, columns, and everything is fine. Base of the column and beam ends are okay. In this particular thing, the modes of failure that are expected and which we don't want, this is not the favorable one, but this is the unfavorable one, is that the connection should not fracture. the column should not buckle, the beam should not fail, and there should not be any tension failure at either the foundation level or in the column member itself. There should not be any failure that should happen. But what should we want is, we want the brace to buckle. Here we are categorically saying that we want the brace to buckle so that it dissipates the energy in the compression side. We want the brace to yield in tension. It should yield, dissipate energy in terms of that hysteresis curve that you have seen. Little bit of column flexure and beam flexure is allowed. Even hinging in beams and columns are allowed. But post, in the severe case only, under DB level, we don't want any hinges to form. DB level, let me say 2.5% interstudial drift level, may we want everything to happen in the brace, nothing in the beams and columns. And while we shift from 2.5 to 5, we shift to saying that, okay, along with some brace buckling and yielding, we can have certain hinges in the beams to be formed. At the beam ends and column base, you can have hinges to form. But yes, it should not fail completely. So this is the favorable. Now, just to show you, this is a hysteresis curve of a brace. And you can see that at the tension side, you can have higher energy dissipation. But at the compression side, look at the black, which is the experimental one, which shows after the elastic buckling of that brace has happened, in subsequent cycles, the compression capacity has come down drastically. So there is a global buckling of the brace. The first thing to happen, you can see at this particular location, global buckling has happened. This is the experimental result and this is the numerical result. Then at this location, local buckling has started. And local, just after the local buckling has occurred, the fracture initial phase starts. So there is a margin between the global buckling or the tensile yielding of the brace member. But as soon as the local buckling of the member occurs, there is fracture initiation which happens at the cross section. So you have your brace going compression tension with your amplitude of that particular compression and tension displacements getting higher and higher. So us case mein, once fracture initiation starts, suddenly the fracture occurs very quickly. Within maybe one or two cycles itself, this particular process happens. So how do we design such a brace frame structure is that, first, okay, if you get that same frame, same building that we have discussed earlier, you decide where to locate your braced frames. Then you determine what kind of configurations that you can go for. So in SMRF, there are limited configurations. You choose one of them. Chevron is there, Splittex is there, single story, in single story itself, X configuration is there. You have to know the advantages and disadvantages of both of them. In Chevron, as I said, you have to design your beam for unbalanced forces. Rest of the things, Splittex is a better one. I mean, if you ask me, Splittex is a better configuration because you don't have to over design your beam just to cater for that unbalanced forces. And then after that, you select your analysis procedure. Yes, our code recommends elastic design procedures like equivalent static force method, response spectrum method, and time history method. And everything is in an elastic phase itself. So what you do is you pick the analysis method and then determine the base shear and story forces. Once you have done that, I mean, in your structure, you have already modeled the braces and all, and you have done the analysis, elastic analysis. You find out what is the brace forces that are coming in the numerical model. For that brace forces, you design your braces. Now, one thing you've got to understand is, if you are going for Chevron, let's say inverted V type of a configuration, when you do this analysis, you will find tension and compression forces that are developed in the braces. In a particular floor itself, you will find both forces there. Because you are doing elastic analysis, you are applying the story shears and all, you will get one brace in tension and one brace in compression at a particular floor. Once you get that, you will understand that compression force is what is governing the design. If you design the brace for your compression, automatically tension forces are getting governed. So once you have decided what is your cross section, yes, I'll choose between hollow square, hollow circular and I section. Since I told you hollow circular and I sections are better, you choose hollow circular for the time being, let's say. If I choose hollow circular, now how do I design my beams and columns? That is the next question. So as per capacity design method, we are making the vulnerable member as my brace, which should yield, buckle and do everything nonlinear as it is. And my beams and columns should be designed for elastic forces. So what we do is we compute the tensile and compressive strength of the brace, the one that we have provided, means expected value of the strength of the brace that we have designed. We are designing as per nominal value, right? We'll get the forces in the braces, compressive force governs the design. So for compressive member under axial force, in compression you will design the brace member, you will get a section. That section will be of a particular grade of material. So for that grade of material, not the nominal value but the expected value, you will find out what is the capacity in tension and compression. For that capacity with an amplitude, with a load factor for dead load and live load, you will design your beams and column members. So what you have done, you have made your beams and columns stronger than your brace. And you follow the normal procedure. You remove the braces, you apply the resultant forces that are coming due to braces. The amplified value which will come, already beams and columns are there with their gravity loads. While designing for gravity load, we will not see the contribution of the braces. If I have a chevron, I have an intermediate support that is there for the beam section. I want to avoid that. I want to design as such key, even if the brace gets damaged, my beam is capable enough to carry that gravity load. That should be what your aim should be. So once you have done that, yes, you have set the hierarchy. If earthquake comes, brace will be the first one to go. I've already over-designed my beams and columns for the amplified whatever load is coming. And then with respect to that, I am looking for a particular performance that I look for. So if I design for that, what is my efficient system definition is that under 2.5% drift, the braces should not undergo fracture, and under 5% drift, which is the maximum limit that we give for a concentrically braced frame, there should not be any collapse that should happen in the structure. Beyond 5, why don't we go is because beyond 5, we are not sure about how the connections for the braces that we have given, whether it will be staying intact or not, that is not sure. So if the connections is not working, your brace obviously will not work. Coming to eccentrically braced frame, yes, earlier the center line was meeting at the center of the beam and it was going like this. Now what we have given is, earlier the sacrificial element in case of concentrically braced frame was the brace. Now the sacrificial element is this link element. This particular section of the steel beam, which is coming in between these braces. So now what we want the all of the inelastic deformations to happen here, and we want this brace to remain elastic, these two braces, as well as the beams and columns to remain elastic under DBE condition. So in this particular, what we say is that in this particular passive device of eccentrically braced frame, our sacrificial element has changed, but the logic of designing that structure and looking at the performance and what is favorable, unfavorable, that pattern remains the same. So you expect, I mean, there are two particular ways in which this is currently popularly given. One in which you have this type of configuration, and one in which you have link to column kind of connection. This is not recommended by ASCE, American Society of Civil Engineers, because this produces damage in the column, which we don't want. Yeah, our column is our, we give it more priority. So we want, like, okay, in this beam particular link element, you can have damage. Now, what kind of damage can it have? I mean, it is being subjected to shear force and moment, and these are the different ways in which eccentrically braced frame. These are the popular ones, and these are the different ways in which eccentrically braced frame configuration can be brought in. Popularly, this one and this one is used. Link to beam connection, this is the link to beam, and this is link to column connection kind of configuration. And you can see the force flow in that particular link section in both the cases. Link to beam, you have a constant shear, you have a varying moment in this location. Whereas in this one, you have, yes, varying moment, yes, you have a constant shear in this particular thing. But there is no axial force in this particular location here. There is axial force that is there. So this kind of configuration, you have no axial force. I mean, literally, by in diagram you can see no axial force, but yes, some small amount will come. But you understand, if there is no axial force, there is no interaction coming into picture. You are looking at shear capacity of the link element, or you are looking at the flexural capacity. Looking at this particular diagram, there is shear force and flexural forces. There is no axial force, so your section will either fail in shear or it will fail in flexure. So how is it getting distinguished? Is E is the term that we used to define the link length. So what the code says, this code is again AIS 34116, because our IS 800 signifies that there is nothing given for eccentrically braced frame as of yet. It says refer to expert literature. So I'm telling you, don't worry till the time that expert literature, I mean, the sections come in. You can look at 34117 and look for designing this thing. And what it says is that if the link length is less than 1.6, then shear will be the, I mean, if you keep a short span of that particular link element. Shear will be the governing. I mean, shear links will be formed. If it is between 1.6 to 2.6, then shear intermediate kind of a link is there, where either shear or flexure will come into picture in terms of energy dissipation. Or if it is greater than 2.6, you are looking at a long link, something like a beam. A long beam, it yields in flexure. Flexure is the dominant behavior. So you will have energy dissipation through the formation of moment hinges. But if it is a short link, you expect the shear to be the governing force. And the hinges that will be formed will be shear hinges, not the flexure hinges. So they say, and the good part is that the smaller the link, the higher the rotational capacity that it has, the higher the energy dissipation it has. So rather surprising. I mean, maybe you might be thinking that the shear hinge might be a bad thing, but shear hinges are having better rotational properties than that of flexural flexural hinges, or what do you say as long links in terms of eccentrically braced fit. Again, the design procedure is same. You make a model of eccentrically braced frames, you give all the braces, you link element, etc. Apply the forces, calculate the story base shear, etc. Apply the forces in the member, and then you design the link first. Then with respect to the design link section, find out what is the forces that is getting transmitted in the brace, beams and columns. Use some amplified load combinations that are there, or increase the material property with the expected value of the brace, and then design your beams, columns and braces such that they remain mostly elastic under design basis earthquake. So that follows. So you expect hinges to form here, here. These are the locations where I have shown what type of hinges can form in places. So in a brace member, axial forces, because your gusset plate does not have out of plane stiffness, so it does not transmit much of the moment to the braces. So you are expecting axial force, like a truss member. In a truss, a diagonal member like thing, you have only majorly axial force. So plastic hinges will form, axial plastic hinges will form. Now, one recommendation I'm giving you guys is, key everyone, that go look at 4170. When we say plastic hinges needs to be formed in the structure, ma'am, I understand I'm reaching my 15 minutes limit. I will take few more minutes only. Then we'll have the question answer session. Just want to finish this. So the hinge that is formed there, when we say axial hinge, moment hinge, PM hinge, if you look at SAP, ETABS and all, which you might be working with your students, or you might be working as such, where do we get the properties? I mean, with respect to strength of a member, yes, we have calculations that are given to calculate what is the flexural capacity of a beam, what is the shear capacity of a beam, we can find out. But the issue comes with respect to what is the rotational capacity of these members. I mean, you have different sections, cross sections, different depth to thickness, flange thickness and all is there. So a good guide right now in terms of getting that numbers is ASC 4170. We currently do not have such kind of data for our members, but it is currently accepted that yes, if you go with their numbers, it is more or less okay if we satisfy that compactness criteria. I mean, it's morally related to that. If your beam section is having certain compactness criteria, this is the rotational capability it has. If your column is having a certain axial load ratio with a certain limit on compactness ratio, this is the rotational capacity it has. That is how this has been given. So you can refer that code for RCC structures as well as for steel structures. You can refer that for connectional rotational capacity as well as for RCC ke liye, for any member or EBF, SCBF, BRBF, it is given. You can refer to that. Now, finally, we are coming to buckling restraint brace frame. So when people started initially with SCBF, in a few years, they understood that this particular asymmetric hysteresis curve that is having very less amount of capacity in the compression side is actually creating a kind of soft story kind of a behavior. I mean, your stiffness is getting reduced as quickly as your member is getting yielded. So you're not getting any kind of compression help on the compression side. So what they did is, in terms of to improve the performance of the brace frame, what they did is they encased this particular element. Like if you consider this line as the brace member, as a steel pipe, let's say, I'm enclosing it inside a concrete shell or a steel shell. The shell, the outer shell, is destined to behave in an elastic manner, but the forces is applied only to the brace member. This is just as a, act as a, the shell, outer shell is acting as a restraining element. if you have studied Euler buckling theorem, I mean the calculation, you must have, you know that there is finally n square pi square ei by l square, that equation that we say. Normally when we say to a student, he says pi square ei by l square is the critical buckling load in the member. What we always do is that we take n as 1 and leave it. If you think, what if I don't go as per the first buckling, the mode of buckling is not the first mode. Let me try to make it achieve higher modes of buckling. If I go for higher n value, I might achieve more strength in terms of compression side. That is what we are doing here. So first, when the axial force reaches the critical buckling load for that particular brace member, it starts to buckle. This is the second mode that is shown here. First mode will be, it is going like this. When it goes like this, it will strike the outer shell member, which is there to restrain that buckling. And the gap, you can assume that it is 2 mm, 3 mm gap only. So we are not allowing it to buckle like 100 mm, 200 mm. I mean, when a brace in a CBF buckles, it buckles almost 200 to 300 mm. But in case of a buckling restrained brace frame, we give that restrainer element only 2 to 3 mm maybe separate from the outer face of that particular brace element. So what you get is, this is the hysteresis curve in comparison to the CBF, where you have such kind of energy dissipation. You have a symmetric energy dissipation in terms of a buckling restrained brace frame. And what happens is that due to this grinding of this particular steel member to the outer core, you might even get some extra compressive forces. I mean, the strength is higher than tension. I mean, you are getting more than yielding ka value. Like if you calculate Fi into Ag as the tension yielding capacity, what you're getting in compression is maybe 1.1 or 1.2 times Fi into Ag in terms of compression side. So that is way this thing. But you can understand one thing now. Earlier, when we were designing our CBF for the tension and compressive forces, and where the compressive forces were governing the design, the section size would be a huge section. Considering that you are trying to govern that design as per the buckling capacity, means the compression capacity, compressive forces developed in the brace member might be 1000 kN. So to achieve 1000 kN, you are designing a brace member who might buckle early, elastic buckling. So your elastic buckling ka ratio, you are trying to increase more, means you are getting a very thick section in terms of CBF, which helps you in getting more stiffness than moment resisting frame. But here, when you look at BRBF section, your section which you are designing is as same as Fi into Ag here, and this is 1.1 or 1.2 Fi into Ag. So what you are ending up with, you are ending up with, yes, safe, what do you say, you are reducing the amount of money that you are spending on the member, brace member, internal brace member which is buckling, but that results in lower stiffness in comparison to CBF. It is intermediate, but buckling resisting brace frame ka stiffness will lie in between moment resisting frame and CBF. Because of that lower stiffness, the problem with buckling resisting brace frame is that once the earthquake is done, is over, most of the time we have a parameter called as the residual drift, which means the permanent deformation that is existing in the structure. If it is less than 0.5%, you can occupy that building. If it is more than that, it is not recommended to occupy that building. You have to demolish it. Most of the cases, buckling restrained brace frame, that 0.5% is not satisfied because of that stiffness criteria, I mean, drift criteria, that it exceeds 0.5% drift. So that is what you got to take care in that. Now, people have done many research in this, whether the outer restraining element has to be concrete, but that concrete is creating trouble in terms of connections. Then they went into all steel. Then they have tried to reduce the length of the BRBF and things like that. But performance-wise, buckling restrained brace frame is a better option. But apart from the residual drift problem, lower stiffness, lower ductility, high ductility it is there. Lower stiffness means high drift will be expected. Apart from that, the problem is BRBF is right now, as a proprietary element, it is being sold. CBF is where you buy a pipe section from the market, you cut it, you design it, and you put it in the structure. You don't want much of things to be done there. But in BRBF, the problem is this mechanism has to work well. That restraining element, the connection has to work well, then only it performs. So in market, there are certain vendors who sell it. So cost-wise, BRBF is very costly in comparison to CBF. The effort is also more in terms of procuring it, then putting it in structure. But CBF can be done very easily. In a developing nation like us, yes, CBF might be a better option. So tell me, can now we are ending this presentation. So last few questions in terms of having fun. What is the difference between all three? I'll make it simple. The only difference, I mean, this question I can answer, maybe it's difficult for you to answer. If you look at this particular structure, which is put in industrial, this thing, this is known as a multi-tiered web-based frame. The function design, everything is similar, but you have to understand that the inertial forces it at this level. Intermediate level, there is no inertia that is being transferred to this particular section. In this particular level, yes, we have inertia being transferred at this particular level. Nothing related to, yes, this is a bad kind of a structural configuration that has to go for brace configuration, which should not be used in SCBF. And here, every level, I mean, you have this brace moving from here to here, called as a mega brace frame. At each floor level, there is inertial forces coming into picture, which is used in tall buildings as such. Now, can you tell me an answer to this? Which all terms will you associate CBF with? One by one, will I choose A or one? Will I say high strength or low strength, a CBF system? Quickly, can you tell me one by one, we'll go. Will I get a high strength out of a CBF system, or will the structural system will be of low strength?
Low strength.
Actually, it is the opposite, is the high strength, because you are over designing due to that compression capacity. You are going and designing for, you are ending up with high strength, less mass material. I mean, strength to weight ratio as well as stiffness to weight ratio is high. So I've answered the second question, that whether it's high stiffness or low stiffness, it is high stiffness in the CBF. So what about third one? Will it have high deformation or low deformation?
High deformation.
If stiffness is high, will I end up with high deformation or low deformation?
Low
deformation.
And if I have high stiffness, will I end up with higher base shear or lower base shear?
Higher base shear.
Now let me associate the same thing with moment resisting frame. Is it a high strength or a low strength in comparison to let's say CBF?
High.
It categorizes itself as a low strength one, but it's okay. It cannot be said as it very simply. But what about stiffness? Can you say specifically stiffness, whether it's high or low in comparison to CBF?
Low stiffness.
So if it is low stiffness, you end up with
higher deformation,
and story base shear will be less in terms of moment resisting frame, because you have a lesser stiffness, so higher time period.
Yeah.
And what about BRBF? Yes, you may say again high strength hosakta, it will be intermediate in between to what we have designed as a moment resisting frame and this thing. In terms of CBF, will it be of a high stiffness or a low stiffness? In terms of concentrically braced frame, with respect to concentrically braced frame, will BRBF be of high stiffness
or low stiffness?
So higher deformation will be expected, and low stiffness means a static base shear will be high. And the last parameter which becomes important in BRBF is the residual deformation, which is there in this particular member, is that it will be higher because you have a lower stiffness in that. Now, is overstrength a good trait? You must have seen this diagram again and again when you use response reduction factor and all. Is overstrength a good trait to have in your structure?
Yes.
Remember?
Maybe depend on the structure.
Huh?
Maybe depend on the structure.
Correct. That is where every time when you answer, you have to categorically think, maybe this is not a simple answer which might be direct to one particular system or something. overstrength is good in terms of what we discussed earlier, but if the member has to satisfy, let's say, strong column, weak beam, overstrength might be a problem there. Then can you tell me where the hinges will form? What type of a structure is it? Is it a CBF? Is it a CBF or an EBF?
EBF. No, CBF.
It's a CBF. It's a CBF. You have to look at the beam level. This is the gusset plate itself that you are looking at. So your center point will come somewhere here. So this is a CBF structure. Okay. I should have drawn the center line also. Then it would have been easier for you guys to identify. This is a CBF. So where would you expect the plastic hinges to form first?
At the mid of the two bases.
Correct. Then where would you want to have your... Look at the drawing specifically, that this is a shear connection given here, this is a shear connection given here. So I'm not expecting
base, any base of the column. Base of the column.
Why cannot it be at the gusset plate itself?
Yeah, gusset.
After this,
maybe at the
base of the column. Then any other place that can form hinge, final hinge maybe. At the final collapse level itself, this can happen, but before that itself, the connection might go off. So there is no point in that. Tell me if something is wrong. This is a CBF structure. Is it right? I mean, is the behavior that what you want, or? Is it good or bad? Is there something wrong? This is a CBF. There is no fracture. There is yielding in the members. But is there something wrong? I'll answer this. The brace is okay. Center of the brace is okay. But at the beam location, this is not where we want our hinges to form in this case. Right outside this particular location where high forces are coming. You don't want this to happen. What about this? First of all, is it an EBF or a CBF?
CBF.
It's a concentrically braced frame or an eccentrically braced frame?
Eccentrically,
of course. You know, 2 hours of lecture, and if somebody has understood, then I'm very happy. This is an EVF structure,
yes, sir.
Where you want yielding to happen in the link element. Yes, the link has yielded, but right outside that particular link element, yielding has happened, which is not the required behavior. So I end my presentation here. I can take few questions from your end.
Sir, this is Nilesh Mishra. I have one question. If you have a multi-story frame and a hinge base is there, how a plastic hinge can form at the hinge base?
No, hinge base, see, one thing you should understand is that key. Hinge base, this is a particular way of representing, okay, the pinned base. You're asking about pinned base, right?
Yes, sir.
See, in a multi-story building, you must understand that there are multiple ways in which different members fail. So what if pinned base at the bottom location, there is no moment that is coming there. There is axial force and there is expected shear force that will be transferred from the column to the particular base that is there. So what I'm saying is, when you're giving hinges in your structure, this is related to that question itself. So
yes,
you must understand that, yes, when I'm giving hinges, I might be prone to give flexural hinges to the beams and PM interaction hinges to the columns. But you must also understand that what if your building dimension is a stout dimension, means shear is more governing. If you give a slender structure, yes, flexure might be governing. If you give a stout dimension, it says that it is a stout, matlab, less height, maybe more base bay width kind of a thing or less bay width kind of a thing in terms of when we are talking about column. So that may govern, that shear might govern the design. So in that case, what I'm saying is shear might govern the design of the hinges. I mean, the hinge that forms at that particular location will be due to shear, and you are not expecting moment hinge to form there. So that failure may happen due to shear. So if you are giving hinges, you must also think about shear hinges in the beams as well as columns. And right now, the newer research is into shear moment interaction. We are looking at axial force moment interaction. People are even looking at considering shear moment interaction also into structure. So the software that you might be using might be only giving you PM as well as M hinges. Yes. But what I'm saying is, in case of pinned bases, you must also look for the option of shear hinges.
Okay. Yeah. Yes. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Anyone else?
You can post your questions in the chat box also.
Ma'am, I can't see the chat box.
Sir, one more question. Again, this is Nilesh Mishra. Sir, yeah. What exactly the response reduction factor in case of, let's say, our IS code is giving only the value of 4 and 5. But whereas if you talk about the Japan as a country, they are having a response reduction factor of nearly 8 or 9. If you talk about the brace frame or if you talk about the moment resisting frame, why we have such a low value of a response reduction factor in our IS 1893 part 1?
I'll answer that in a sense that in American code, Japanese code, it might be 6 and 8. I mean, for SCD, yes, 6, for BRB, if it is 8 and all. But if you look at Euro code and all, it is similar to what we have given. So a study was done in this regard, and it was understood that in American, with respect to American Indian code, there is a difference. I mean, in our value, it might be a huge difference between 5 and 8. It might be a huge difference, but their soil factors and our soil factors ke basis pe, in the end, it is more or less same only. We are not undermining from our end. I mean, what I can tell you is that we are not undermining our end of the way in which we design our SCBF. Mm-hmm. In consideration of those soil factors, the value that they use for FA, FE, those kind of value that they take for soil and the structural systems. If you combine everything, if you look at the base shear that we design our structure for and they design, I mean, eventually it comes down to what is the base shear that we design for. It is more or less similar. So it is there. We are considering, we are not making the mistake of considering SCBS as a lower ductile system. We are considering with equal weightage only. But if you look at the final output that we are interested in, this base shear, that way it comes more or less similar only.
Okay. Okay. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, sir. I am Sumit Thakur. I am working on, sir, energy dissipating devices, and in that buckling restraint braces. So, sir, what are the current insights related with the different shapes of buckling restraint braces?
No, it is something like what I have seen till now is that people have worked upon different ways of, the outer shell. I mean, with concrete people have gone, with all steel it has come out. In terms of length of the buckling restraint brace frame, in order to increase the stiffness of the system, people have tried joining BRBF in line with common CBF member. Means a short length of a BRBF and a long length of CBF combined together, they have tried to improve the stiffness of the member. But what lacking thing that I find with respect to the connection design, every BRBF test that you look at, every paper that you look at, the failure that is seen is mostly not seen in the core element. You can go for a plate element inside covered by concrete. You can go for a plate element covered by all steel. In the end, the connection failure happens where there is a transition between that BRB of outer element and the, what do you say, as the gusset plate or the non-core element kind of a region. So you can look into that particular area with respect to connection if you are looking for anything new in BRBF.
Okay, sir. Okay. So specifically, it relates with connection. How we connect BRB with RCC yes. members or steel members.
Yes, yes. Not even that. BRBF member to gazette plate also itself is the question that I am speaking.
Okay, okay, sir. Okay.
That core element to gazette plate, there is a big transition happening, right? From the inside, outside, it is a core element. The core element should not carry any force. I mean, core element carries the axial forces, but outer element should not carry any axial forces. So that interaction between that element, how it transforms from that core element to a non-yielding element, that is where things have to be done first.
Okay, sir. Okay, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Sir, one question I want to ask.
Please, please.
Sir, actually, I am working on performance-based design of RC buildings. And in that, I want to brace my frame. So, which type of configuration would be suitable for it?
You are going for a concentrically braced frame.
Okay, concentrate.
No, I'm asking you, are you going, I mean, you're adding braces to it, right, you said?
Yeah. So but
No, if it is an RCC structure, I mean, you're working on an RCC structure performance-based design, or are you doing something on...
Yeah, I'm working on RCC RCC.
I can tell you that what you're trying to do right now, in terms of adding a brace configuration, it is always good to go with split-ex. Means one V, inverted V in one floor, and V in the next floor.
Okay.
But the main problem in this particular aspect, just to add on to that, is performance-based design aspect is good. RC ka performance-based design is good. But when you bring in a steel element, the connection, the how will you bond it to it, how are you incorporating that in your model, becomes the bigger issue. So if you're doing just a numerical problem of frame analysis, right now you can go ahead with it. You can give a moment release at the edge of the brace members and go ahead with the calculations. Considering that that moment release is to signify that gusset plate is there, which cannot take out of plane bending. So that's good enough in the current case. But if you're going further, how will you connect the brace to the RC member? One of the things that I am currently doing at Roorkee is that only. Connection to a steel frame to an RC member.
So I'm actually working on SAP 2000. So
now you have to be careful. One advice I'll give you is that if you're working on SAP 2000, SAP 2000 ka, when you give hinges and all these buttons which is giving auto hinges, you have to understand what is auto hinge doing, then only proceed. You may be using FEMA 4117 and all, it will be going for. I mean, the codes that I've mentioned, it will be telling, okay, auto hinge means this is taken from this code, but there are many things related to that. I mean, when you define a material, it asks you for nominal value as well as the expected value. All those numbers are related to what you tell to do it under this thing, 4117.
4117. Okay.
Yeah.
And in terms of FEMA 356?
FEMA's 356 is the older one. I mean, older version that has been improved, and now the latest one is 4170.
4170. Yeah. But I think it has focused over the demand capacity ratio and shear hinge, I think.
It has even more. It will give you rotational capacity. Whatever you are giving using auto hinge, it will give you that value there.
Okay.
Different tables are given in terms of RCC members also it is given, in terms of steel also it is given.
Oh, okay, sir. Thank you.
Anyone else? You can send your questions directly to my mail ID also. If you have any queries, if you are working on something and you are stuck, you can send queries to my email ID. You'll find it on our website.
Okay, I think there are no more questions. So thank you, sir, on behalf of Sri Venkateshwara College of Engineering and all the participants here. I thank you very much for this lecture. It was very informative, a detailed one, and easily understandable. And it was good to have questions in between so that all participants were actually active also. And thank you for clearing all the doubts patiently. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for this opportunity. And I'm always ready to give lectures on steel structures. If in future, if something is required on steel structures, I'll be always ready to help each and every one of you. So no, not an issue. Thank you for this opportunity once again.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.